Hello and welcome. I have Tina with me. Tina, congratulations. You qualified your JRF exam in code 55 in December 2019. Tell us more about your journey. How are you feeling now?
Certainly not on the top of the world, but okay, let's see. It's a dream. No, it's a dream coming true in the sense I have been trying it for the past 3 times. So I was qualifying only NET. I was trying for JRF, and finally in December 2009, I had qualified it. Because every time when I qualified NET, it was only 1.3% difference for to JRF and UGC NET. There was not much difference, so that I could give up. And there was not enough motivation, but I thought it's only 6 months of gap between every NET exam that we have. So I thought, why not give another shot? It's just 6 months. So, but certainly this has helped me to boost up my confidence again, that see, practice and practice and never give up until you get it.
Well said. And we would like to know more about you. Where are you from, and when did you finish your post-graduation, and what was going on through your head from 2015 until you cleared your JRF? Take us deeper into your journey.
No, I completed my master's in 2015. So for the next 1 year, I worked teaching to international kids. So that was basically a homeschooling. It was for a charity institute. So I was into it, and I was giving schooling to them. Then later on, after, I thought there was no career opportunities over there. So then I thought of giving a try to competitive exams. So what NISTE have done is that for the 2 years, I thought I was never being perfect to give an exam. I was only mugging up what I had. I was only going through the facts. I was studying. But I never had the confidence that, yes, I'm ready to give the exam. So these 2 years, I've not given any exam. I never tried it. So after that, I realized that there is nothing called, there's no phrase called being perfect in giving a competitive exam. You need to be best in what you study. You need to be best in your confidence levels. It should be very high. That's it. There's nothing being perfect. But it took time to for me to realize it. But then again, at that point of time, all the PSUs were concentrating on UGC NET. They were selecting the candidates on the basis of this, on basing the score that we get from UGC NET. So I thought HR is my favorite subject. Instead of me going through every stream, in the sense, like, what I wanted to say is, if you go into a competitive, it's in various competitive exams, there are different streams, there are different subjects that you need to concentrate. Instead of that, I wanted to concentrate on which subject I am perfect. I am good at HR. So I thought, why should I leave my own comfort zone where I'm comfortable and move into another zone and create and be myself in an uncomfortable zone? I thought so. And I thought, let me come back. Let me go through my academic books, what I had. So finally, then I realized, okay, UGC NET is perfect. So let us crack first this exam. So that I had in many opportunities, not only through competitive exams, but through UGC NET also, we have many opportunities in PSUs. I mean, many people don't know this. I think whatever opportunities we have by cracking UGC NET, the same options we find it outside also. So instead of writing 4 or 5 exams, you concentrate only one exam, which gives you best score, and you get into a good PSUs. That's a good HR. The purpose of studying masters is to be a good HR. But after I left my masters, there are many people, they say, I was hearing to many people, some people say, see, HR is not good for women. So basically what at the young age, when you come out as a fresher, we tend to move to different things that we hear. Like some say this is good for you, some say that is good for you. So this went on for me for 1 year. So I wasted my valuable time. So I want to say that be strong, take time. First, let you yourself know what you want. Then get into what you want to study and make a plan for it. So that's how I came into this. I wanted to prepare for UGC NET.
That's amazing. And which city were you born in? Where do you hail from?
I was born in Odisha, and it's a small town called Parla Khimundi. So I belong to that place. But we don't have proper educational facilities over there. So for the studies, I just moved to Visakhapatnam, and I finished all my right from my plus two inter to post graduation. I finished in Visakhapatnam, and it is affiliated to Andhra University.
Great. And coming to the point that you were saying that it takes time to realize what you really want to do, because there are conflicting advices given to us from, you know, n number of advice coming from n number of people, and it takes time for a person to realize what they actually are good at. So do you think this is a challenge especially for girls, because there is a paucity of time, because there's a kind of pressure from the society and your family, if not direct but indirectly, that there is a right age to get married, there is a right age for everything. So there is a special kind of added pressure on girls, if I say so.
Yes, that was a challenging thing, but mostly, like, you know, I'm really thankful that I could get the acceptance from my parents to do. But it was a tough time, because every year, you know, this is a time, like every day passes by, but you know, you feel that you're running out of time. You're near to your marriage age and you have to get married. This pressure was put on me. Not that my parents asked me to get married. It was the people from everywhere. Like my relatives, whatever it is, at the beginning of my career, they used to pressurize me. But later on, whatever the trust that I gained from them, made them to think that, okay, let she be given a chance to do whatever she likes. So they have given me this 3 years of time. That's a good thing to be acknowledged. So the pressure that I felt was that I was not able to crack, because I was a gold medalist from my post, a gold medalist for my masters, and being a gold medalist, you know, people come and they mock at me that, see what my daughter will do if my daughter does MBA like you, even she'll be left over like this. So these are the common conflicting things that I used to hear. So these used to create a pressure on me. So later on, what I did is, best possible thing is to switch off our phone, not to be in contact with anyone. Only since you are away from your parents, just I used to call my parents daily, every day I used to call them. That's it. I never called anyone until I thought I need not give explanation to anyone about what I'm doing. Only my actions have to show them. So that is what I have realized throughout my preparation.
I think you've described it very well. I could relate to every word you were saying, because at some point of time, being a girl, I have gone through those times when you feel that everything you do is not right because it's not related to marriage, so anything else is a time waste. So
yes,
I understand, and good to hear that you were the gold medalist. That is amazing, and that's why I think you cracked NET so many times, and now you have your JRF. So no doubt you're an extraordinary student. So tell us about your preparation strategy, as to how much time did you give to each subject and how did you divide your time between paper one and paper two. So dwell more into the details of your preparation.
Preparation strategy is like, see, when I first started to study NET, UGC NET, at that time UGC was conducting the exam. At that time the pattern was like only mugging up the facts that was given to us. So once when I went to the previous year question papers and we started, there was a time when UGC was taking the NET papers. We can ensure that at least 10% of the questions get repeated every year. So we used to go through the previous year question papers. So when I went through the pre-books, I prepared everything. But when you start analyzing your previous year question papers, I came to a point where I couldn't think beyond that. I was very confused and I was completely stagnant over there. I couldn't think what's beyond this preparation. What is it? Everything got jumbled up. I couldn't pick up one website wherein there is guidance for everything. For example, if you take for UPSC, we have n number of websites, n number of videos that could guide us exactly what to do. But I couldn't find, at that time I had no idea about human peritis. So I was in a confused state. Later on, when I was looking into some website, I came through this human peritis. So when I opened the human peritis site, clearly there were many guidelines written on human peritis website as to what, how you have to analyze the questions. So that was the point. You know, by the time I cracked my first UGC NET, first time I cracked NET only, I didn't get my JRR. So then I thought, let me give it a try. So I went through your website, I completely analyzed whatever the guidelines you have given through, and I started to practice those guidelines. I say human peritis material, whatever I have ordered, is very precise. But to understand what human peritis is, first we have to go through our academics books, because human peritis is very precise and it is very helpful to revise the entire concept in one go. So in order to do this, first we have to study our academics, be perfect in our academics, then only we can know that what is the purpose of the human peritis material. So first, what they have done, if we have 4 months time to prepare for UGC NET, first 2 months I spent only in preparing my notes from the academics books. I prepared my notes, then I have taken the human peritis material. So I keep it aside, my notes and human peritis material, and I highlight the points what it needed to be. I can show you the books, human peritis book. Literally, I have my labor law book is completely filled with sections and highlighting important. Even though I come through an important amendment or recent amendment in the website or any of the websites, we just write it on the book only. So what, you know, it's very handy. So 1 month before the exam, I don't touch any of my books. I only keep this material and only I revise that. And my preparation strategy for the subjects, in the sense, I was very weak in paper one compared to paper two. I was very sure that if out of 100, I can fetch 80 to 85 marks. But paper one was little difficult for me. So make sure that I give both the subjects equal amount of time. So per day, if I study for 12 hours, 6 hours would be for paper 1 and 6 hours would be for paper 2. And the most important thing most of the people forget while preparing for UGC NET is that we don't stick on to the syllabus. Most people don't stick on to the syllabus. We might think that so there are many recent amendments, recent current affairs. So we concentrate more on other things rather than what is necessary to us. people say that I have cracked NET exam twice, so it was easy for me in the third attempt to clear JRF. No, it was not. When UGC was there, we had some questions getting repeated. But he has taken NET exam when NTA is conducting. Now, I mean, for the past three attempts, I thought, past two attempts, I have been giving through NET, which is taken up by NTA. So when NTA is taking up the exam, all the questions are very practical. We need analyzation, and none of the questions are being repeated. So I would say one mistake that I have done is for my second attempt is first time when NTA has taken up. Every time when UGC is conducting the exams, it used to ask, like we had in labor welfare, we have trade unions, like international federations. So they used to ask past, who is the past president, who is the first president. So we all always used to learn those names of the presidents who were in the past. When NTA took up, he asked who is the present president of International Federation of USA. None of the people know. People, I can say for sure the people who got it right was also a guess. It was a guessed answer. No one could answer it. You know, next time when I was preparing for the NET, I went through it. Who is the present president of international, all the international federations around the, I mean, of different countries. But there was no question in NTA, in UGC NET. There was no question. So I thought, so when once you go out of the syllabus, everything gets messed up. You mess up with things. The only thing you have to do is, first of all, finish whatever you have in your syllabus. First, concentrate on the syllabus. The other things what you have, you just give it once a revision and you go to the exam. Instead of what we do is, if we mess up with everything, we forget what is important and we study a lot of unnecessary things, which is not necessary, not at all necessary for the NET exam.
I think I totally agree with a lot of things you just said. That people just go with the flow, go in depth of certain topics which are not required. So sticking to the syllabus is the most important thing. And that the questions are not repeated, the concepts are repeated. So for that, going through the questions properly from last year and knowing all the four alternatives in detail helps you attempt a similar kind of question, because the question will not come again. So whatever you said was absolutely something I resonate with, and I'm sure a lot of people will help, will be helped through these things that you shared. So before I conclude the interview, if you had to, apart from what we have already discussed, if you had to give like one mistake that everyone should avoid who's sitting for this exam of labor laws, what should that mistake be?
One mistake that no one should repeat is that going out of the syllabus. Do not go out of the syllabus. I would only request it, and don't procrastinate your things. What is to be done today is to be done today. Whatever subject it might be, finish it off for today. Don't procrastinate for tomorrow. That's one advice I would like to give.
Thank you so much, Tina, for all those words of advice. And it's easier said than done, that don't procrastinate. I think it totally depends on how driven you are and how important personally for you it is to get, because I was surprised to hear that you studied 12 hours a day, but kudos to you, you made it, and we wish you all the best for all your future endeavors. May you soon be sitting in one of the PSUs in your dream company. And
yes,
thank you so much for taking out so much time and speaking with us.
Thank you for having me here.